to be cooking with the executive head chef in their new cellar. Matt Gillan, how are you? Fantastic to see you, mate. Are you keeping well?
Yeah, good.
Thank you for a very good lunch. Just before I start, I get criticised in quarters for being far too enthusiastic with chefs, and I promised myself I'd be reserved today. But having just had that lunch, I can't. It was fantastic.
And we'll talk.
Yeah. Well, I need to talk. Obviously, we'll talk that through in a minute. So, for those who haven't met you before, if you could just give us a bullet point history of your career so far.
So, the age of 15, started in a pub in Hampshire called the Head and Chicken. Worked with Nick for about 2 years there, and followed him to Hunters in Oxford. And from there, it was a huge, massive jump in terms of standards and quality when I went to Midsummer House with Daniel. Back in the day, before the rosettes and the stars and the TV, I spent 3.5 years with Daniel. And then went on to Restaurant Gordon Ramsay. I spent just under a year there.
That was a hospital road?
Hospital road, yeah.
You survived?
Yeah, I survived.
Fantastic.
It was, believing there was more through the repetition of the restaurant, which I totally understand. You know, it's 3 stars for a reason. When you're quite young and enthusiastic, you just want to, you know, absorb as much information as possible. You know, doing the same thing day in, day out gets a little bit repetitive, and eventually kind of through boredom, I left it, really. And then I went to Vineyard at Stockos with John Campbell. I spent a year with him.
That must have been really exciting.
Loved it. Absolutely loved the year of it. You know, learned so much every day. There was something new to learn. And John's knowledge of food and the science behind the food is just, it's awe-inspiring. So you know, every day there's a question you need to ask. And you have John, and say, you know, why does this do this? And he's got the answer. And if he doesn't have the answer, he won't kind of mess around and say he doesn't know. You know, dig out the books and read why things aren't. Why things do what they do.
So, yes.
So it was constant learning for a year. And then I just took a break, took a year out, went to Australia, lived in a van, picked fruit, vegetables.
As you did?
It was good.
I avoided the sharks and the snakes and the spiders.
Yeah. This dish is cured and charred mackerel. Apple preparations, watermelon, and anchovy. We'll start with the compressed apple slices. So they've just been vat packed with Wobblegate apple juice. So it's literally just down the road from us. They make freshly pressed apple juice. Vacuum tight, left for 12 hours, it just absorbs the apple juice. Gives it a more apple-y flavour. Next, compressed watermelon. So skin removed, seeds removed, and then just compressed. It gives it a much fuller watermelon flavour. Texture's a lot denser. Just makes watermelon nice, in my opinion. I'm not a fan of it, just kind of straight out of off the shelf. Roasted apple puree, so the apples are pierced and then put into the oven, just roasted until they start bursting, start to colour up on the tray. It's a little bit different to cooking the apples in a pan, and just gives it a deeper flavour, just a nice roasted apple flavour on the dish. Poached apple, apple juice brought up to the boil, and then the apples just dropped in. Mackerel's been cured for 3 hours in equal amounts of salt and sugar, star anise, coriander seeds, and cardamom seeds. Mm.
tapenade. It adds a nice saltiness to the dish, but different salty to the cure of the mackerel.
Which is always good.
So, how did you? There's a lot of 16-year-olds out there who have either sort of underperformed in school, who aren't quite bright, or perhaps have mixed parenting or haven't been given the right guidance, who would make fantastic chefs. How did you fall into cooking? Was it something that you always wanted to do, or was it something that you just fell into? How did you do in school? How did you do in college?
I started in catering at the pub where my best friend was working, so he was he was pot washing for 2 days a week and earning half much money. And I was doing a paper round at the time, earning a lot less, doing 7 days a week, delivering papers in the rain, the snow, like everything, every type of weather. So I asked him to get me a job, which he did. And then he started cooking, because it was better than washing up.
Yeah.
So I was just washing pots and pans. I thought that was quite good. And we had a chef leave, and also my best mate didn't want to kind of do it anymore, you know, didn't think it was for him. So I said to Nick, the chef, can I put the whites on? He said, well, you get someone to wash up, and yeah, of course. So I got my brother involved, and it just went from there. And you know, the more I started picking salad and, you know, prepping the carrots and the cauliflower for Sunday lunch, and the more I did, the more I was involved, the more I enjoyed it, the more I wanted to do, the more I wanted to learn. So yeah, kind of fell into it through, you know, a need for money at that point.
You've actually joined, incidentally, you've just become an honorary member of a club of most of the top chefs in the UK who just fell into it and discovered it with their love. And obviously you feel that you were born to be a chef, or are you like a frustrated surfer or a frustrated rock star? Or?
I don't think frustrated anything. I think when I was at school, I was going to be a graphic designer. So, I've always been into art and design and just playing around and creating. And it wasn't a conscious decision to go into food and cooking. You know, it was never a background. You know, eating was eating to live. It wasn't a privilege for us. You know, we didn't go out to all these fancy restaurants when we were younger because we couldn't afford to. So yeah, it wasn't. Yeah. You know, I wasn't at my nan's heels, you know, making cakes every Sunday afternoon either. So it was a case of, you know, at that point I needed money, and then, you know, there were at the time I thought, you know, the cooking was better than washing up to do. And it was just a need to learn, really. I think that's what it was. And the fact that it's cooking is very much related to creating, and especially my food is very much quite artistic, it's very pretty. It just kind of satisfies my need to design, to create, to be artistic. So
you do blend your flavours like colours, and your dishes portray a theme as if it almost was a painting to some degree. Is that a coincidence, or do you think that?
No, that's pure coincidence. You know, things aren't on plates just for the sake of it. You know, there's not the greenery on plate just because it's, you know, right at the moment we're in the middle of winter. We've just had, you know, snow covering us for the last week. So, yeah. You know, to be putting things green on plates because, you know, that's what people should do. You know, it's not what I do. It's not the reason behind, you know, these blending of colours, as you say. It's just pure coincidence.
It works well. Tell me what you think the difference between fame and recognition is, and which one do you hanker after, or indeed hope to achieve one day?
When I started cooking, I didn't continue to cook. I didn't do it for the fame aspects. You know, I didn't watch Ready Steady Cook and think, yeah, I'm going to be the next Tony Tobin or James Martin. You know, I started and continue to cook because I enjoy doing what I do day in, day out. I do, you know, we don't do it for massive amounts of money. You know, and if you wanted to do it for massive amounts of money, then you go and be famous and do it properly, go to acting school. So for me, fame is not something I'm after. I'm not chasing that at all. pasta is becoming well recognised, and I'm really proud of that. So fame over recognition, you know, recognition every day. I think it's just a, it's kind of a pat on the back. It's a sense check as to how you're doing, how you're performing, and makes the hours that you put in really worthwhile. So, you know, the fact that the past and myself are becoming a little bit more well known, you know, I'm really happy with, you know, but I'm not going to be the next celebrity chef, and I have no desire to be.
Unless the marketing people leap on you and shove them on their, on your pedestal, on their pedestal.
Well, you know, they do try. I'll probably get myself in trouble now, but they do try, and I have been put forward to do certain programs, and you know, I just don't want to. I'm not interested. It's not why I cook.
Fantastic.
So I want to be in my kitchen. Any spare time is either spent with my family, which is, you know, just as important as the job. More important, it keeps you kind of on the ground. It keeps you level-headed, but. You know, any time outside of that, it's heads in books and how can we progress the restaurant? How can I develop myself?
You know, as soon as they watch this, you'll become an even bigger target because your humility is so appealing. So just watch out for that.
I'll make myself an old
leg and crispy belly of rabbit, white beans, chocolate jelly, and other ingredients. Yeah. Start with white bean puree. White beans have been soaked in sparkling water for 24 hours. And then we cook them in a pressure cooker for half an hour with the usual mirepoix kind of bits and pieces. Leg of rabbit, salted for 24 hours, just molten salt, and then we cook them really, really gently in duck fat. It doesn't even come up to the boil, just really, really gently. Pick it down, mix it with tarragon and chervil, balance it up, slice it, and then let it come up to room temperature. Poached carrot. So the carrots cooked down in orange juice, cooked right down to a syrup, topped up again with orange juice, and the juice down again, and we keep doing that until the carrot's cooked. Chocolate jelly is just water. And 70% dark chocolate set with veg gel. Sorry. Semi-dried tomatoes. Take the tomatoes down to petals, salt, sugar, thyme, pomace oil, and a tiny bit of garlic. And then we put them onto a tray, just let them kind of air dry for about 12 hours. Don't want to take them too far because we want that nice soft texture in there, but we don't want them too wet. Poached prunes, they're poached in Armagnac, sugar, vanilla, white wine vinegar, and salt.
In what aspect of your work do you get the biggest buzz and the biggest satisfaction? Is it the perfect dish? Is it bringing on staff? Is it like praise from your guests? What is it about the job that gives you that perfect satisfaction feel?
I think it's a combination of everything, you know, and that's what's so great about this job. You know, in an office you do, you know, you hit your targets, it's a pat on the back. Well, if you hit your targets, you might get a bonus. I mean, there's no other reward other than, you know, that pat on the back, thanks very much, here's an extra couple of pounds in your packet. For me, creating a menu and experience that the guests love, want to come back to. You know, some, you know, we have quite a few people say it's an amazing experience and we've never tried this or this or this. It makes me really happy that we've kind of created this like destination for them, this experience for them, and especially for the celebration. But then you've got the junior chefs that, you know, come up to me and say, you know, Matt, learned so much today, or, you know, can I go on these stages, or, you know, to these restaurants that are better than us? And that gives me a sense of achievement because they're starting to think of, you know, where we are and how they can develop themselves.
Mm.
So, yeah, and if, you know, I'm looking to send my guys out on stages all this year, and if I lose one of my guys to one of these better restaurants, do you know what, that's absolutely fine because they've gone somewhere better than where we are and they've been, you know, offered a job. So that's a massive achievement. That gives me a real sense of achievement and, you know, that fuzzy feeling inside.
Turning into also, a father figure.
Well, exactly. I know it's quite bizarre, but I do have a responsibility to them. You know, it's not just about doing what I want to do and, you know, them doing what I say they do. You know, we're nurturing the future here. We talk about the shortage of talent coming through and skills, and, you know, that is our responsibility as head chefs to develop these guys to make sure, you know, they do continue, and that the food going forward and in the future is as good as, if not better than what it is now.
Just to let the audience know that this is a raw and live interview, and we have the janitor changing the lights at the moment.
Well, we have the restaurant manager changing the light bulbs, yeah.
Here we are.
Restaurant manager is getting a shock now.
He's getting a shock. There you go, we're just completely live. This is completely unprompted. What do you think either the government or colleges or parenting or society, one or either or a combination of those, are they promoting our industry enough as an industry in which you can get a really enjoyable career and satisfaction out of?
Yes and no. I think there's a lot that is being done, but there's still a lot that can be done as well. There's so many horror stories, I think, with especially certain TV programs that portrayed the industry and especially kitchens as these you know, violent areas to work in. You know, you come into work and you just get shouted at all day and with no rewards, and, you know, it's not the reality.
Yeah.
And hopefully the past goes some way to kind of disperse that.
Oh, it does.
You know, we're an open kitchen and we get so many comments about, you know, how quietly, how efficiently the kitchen runs, you know, the fact there's no shouting or swearing or screaming, and we get beaten up. And it's nice, and for me, that's what the environment I want to achieve. And I think that it'd be nice if that was reflected a bit more on the TV, but then it doesn't make great viewing on TV.
No, it doesn't.
You know, so at the end of the day, you have to kind of take a pinch of salt with TV. It is there to create, to attract an audience and to create a viewing experience.
Mm.
I think the government really holds the key. I work quite closely with a few colleges and, you know, I speak to them and their funding keeps getting cut every year.
Yeah.
Which is a real surprise if you look at how much revenue the hospitality industry generates for the country. And so, you know, if they looked at that a little bit more and, you know, realised if they put a bit more into training and developing, you know, people, like kids really, grassroots level, you know, we could really.
I think that's a great play to be your local MP, you know, and then potentially Prime Minister after that, Matt, maybe. The first chef to be Prime Minister.
Amazing.
We'd become the centre of the culinary world for sure then.
Get stuff done, won't we?
But and I'm not saying, yeah, this is an excuse, but and you're absolutely right, you know, we agree with your point. But hey, like, for all those cuts, we do get there, and we have some amazing talent, including yourself, in this country, that somehow falls into it accidentally and kicks into it and sort of moves on, really. So
definitely, it'd be nice to have the time to proactively be able to go and source that talent, you know, and hit it as soon as, you know, your school leavers are the perfect people. And I'm not saying don't go to college, come straight into work, because I think the colleges do play a really important role, and think if chefs spent a little bit more time with the colleges, they'd understand just the pressures that they're under. So for us to put the blame on colleges...
You can't. It's not the college's fault.
It's not the college's fault. You know, it's their lack of resource. And, you know, I feel really sorry for them.
Yeah,
because they're just under pressure.
Yeah, okay.
But yeah, in terms of parents as well, I think they just have no idea what the hospitality industry is. You know, again, the only view they get is what you see on the TV. There is nothing else. You can't. You know, everyone knows what it's like to work in an office. You don't have to watch The Office to know what it's like to work in the office, because most people do.
Yeah.
But hospitality is, there's so much more to it than, you know, the long hours. You know, the sense of satisfaction, like job satisfaction, is unrivaled. I think there's any other industry that's like hospitality.
You get a high every day. You get a buzz every day. You're about creating harmony, you're inspiring, you know, it's all of those wonderful things that most people in offices wouldn't even potentially.
Every day is different.
Okay. Fillet of beef, ox tongue, mushroom puree, parsley and shallot. Ox tongue, brined for 24 hours and 70 grams of salt per litre of water. And then we cook that in bath, 66 degrees for 24 hours. And just let it cool, slice it. All the trim is then used, diced up, and will be in the sauce a bit later on. Mushroom dust is made from all trim of mushroom that we have, so anything that we're not using on a dish, we'll then dehydrate it or blitz it up to a powder. The mushroom puree is encapsulated in mushroom jelly. So the puree is made with button mushrooms and wild mushrooms cooked down in a little bit of chicken stock. Once it's fully cooked through, we blend that up, freeze them in hemisphere molds, and then dip them in mushroom jelly made from a mushroom stock, which is set with vegetable gel. And then it's dipped into the jelly and then sets straight away, and then we're allowed to defrost in mushroom stock.
So Matt, just looking inside yourself, okay, where are you going as a chef? What whilst you're hitting your targets and you're developing other people in, you know, a bit of TV, Great British Menu soon, people, where are you going yourself? How are you developing your skills, and how much better do you think you can be as a chef?
That's a fully loaded, tough question, that one. Where am I going? I don't know. You know, every goal or accolade I thought I could achieve, and, you know, where my end goals we've kind of done now. And so it's quite a bizarre feeling to know you've achieved what you set out to achieve. So it's just kind of taking stock of where we are. And
how old are you?
32. 32 last week.
Congratulations.
So yeah, it's just, you know, what are the next targets? Do you make the targets accolade based? But then by doing that, you're just kind of chasing the accolades. You're not really focusing on the people that kind of allow you to continue doing what you do, the guests. So for me, it's just, you know, how good can it be? I can't answer that question because I don't think I'd be where I am now 10 years ago. So in 10 years, who knows, you know, I think it's just constantly reading, playing around, developing, speaking to people, getting out, eating, stages. You know, I'm not too proud to go and work in someone else's kitchen because it could be the smallest thing I see that could, you know, flourish into something else. So,
yeah.
You know, and there's so many better chefs out there than me, you know. I'm just, for me, I'm at the bottom of the rung, you know. It's the bottom of the ladder for me, so.
Why do you say that?
How do you
judge yourself to others?
Me, like Four Rosettes was a real shock. I didn't think we were ready for it at the time. I didn't think, you know, I look at the other Four Rosette restaurants in the country and I think, you know, we're now on the same kind of level of pegging as them. And it's quite a, because these are the guys that I've looked up to for years and, you know, eat at their restaurants and, you know, buy their books or, you know, constantly follow them and, you know, all of a sudden I'm, you know, on the same platform as these guys. So, but I like that feeling of still feeling like the underdog because it keeps me going and it spurs me on. You know, the day I say, do you know what, I deserve to be here, you know, well, if that's the case, then I probably should just kind of hang up my apron and just sit behind the desk and do other bits and pieces.
Okay. It's been a really good interview, Matt. I think your professionalism, your humility and your skill and your wisdom, you're quite wise for your age, if you don't mind me saying so. I think that really comes across, and I think if there's any young chefs watching, I think it's a real lesson for them to see what you can make out of this career. So thanks very much for your time.
Thanks
very much. Cheers.